So howdy, my name's Amanda Lakin. My master's is actually over the Native Prairie Restoration on Memorial Park. I'm at the point now where I'm kind of like, what the heck was I thinking? But that's I'm working under Dr. Fred Smines, which is where are we at? Where'd we go? I call him Johnny Rainfeld sometimes because he can get a little down the mouth about the remnant prairies and how the positive Paul, Dr. Smines. Come on. Anyway, so we got together with the Memorial Park Conservancy and Houston Livestock Show and Rodeo to come in and try to repair some of these prairies that have just been pretty much demolished. Right there where the star is, if anybody's not familiar with where Memorial Park is, that's Memorial Park, and where the star is where my research plots are. It's right behind the Running Trail Center. You can't, if you come down that road, you can't miss me. And that is actually the picture of my research area, and you can see two of my big problems right there in that picture. One, I've got a railroad on one side that I have no idea what they're rooming at. And then the walking trail, while it's great for PR and I get to talk to people, which can be an issue, but you know, it's kind of, guys, I really need to get work done, but you know, education's great. But also, we had to fence it off so people's dogs weren't going in, because even though they're on the leash, they're not holding them on the leash, and they're tracking stuff in the plots and everything else. Two of our main species, or we're trying to reestablish the native grass, and we know that not just the grass, but the forbs as well, the general diversity of that native prairie. You can't do that if you don't get rid of your invasives, or at least knock them back to give your natives a chance to come. And where we're at, our biggest problem is the Claybor bluestem. I have the scientific names up there, I'm not going to say them, but if you need them, there they are. The Claybor bluestem is pretty much a monoculture. There's a little bit of forbs here and there. We were actually surprised to find as many forbs as we did because the bluestem is so thick through there. And there is some King Ranch, our KR bluestem, not nearly as much as we thought. It's predominantly Claybor. And the reason it has gotten such a stronghold in there is, I don't know if y'all saw before, okay, that's the high line. You can kind of see the poles. So we're right underneath the main high voltage high line. So they mow it a lot. And it has completely wiped out a lot of our native grasses. Part of our idea is that we've seen that Claybor and King Ranch are not overly shade tolerant, so we're trying to come up with ways to shade them out. And part of it is to plant big, robust, tall, high biomass native species like switchgrass and shade it out naturally. The problem is if you don't do anything and just try to plant it, you know, other than mow, we mowed everything, but if you just mow and then throw some switchgrass seed down, it comes back and chokes it out. You don't get anywhere. So we're going more with a total removal of the established Claybor and King Ranch, and then overseeding with the native species after that. And what we have come in and done is spread glyphosate, which that's fun when you have the joggers going by and you've got the big tank out there spraying, people are freaking out. It doesn't work, you can't use it to your advantage. Put a sign, herbicides applied, you won't have anybody going there. take advantages where you can, right? As far as the challenges, weather is a huge one, just like anything. You know, if you want to hear Mother Nature, the fates of God laugh, tell them your plans. We got a really late start because, well, for one, we had funding issues. It's, so sometimes happens. And then when we finally got everything cleared up and we went to make our move to start setting up plots and spraying and mowing, it rained like every day.
Yep.
For 3 weeks. And we're like, well, we can't mow, you can't spray, you can't do anything. We actually sprayed in front of we got the spray down good. We seeded in front of a thunderstorm. We got done, cleaned everything out, got the rigs out of the plots, and within 10 minutes, it was pouring. So, that kind of stuff. Right now, the spring treatments aren't doing too well. I don't know if it's because we got in so much later. We didn't get seed in until May, the second week in May. So that's a little bit past the NRCS guideline cutoff date of April 15th. We do have some fall treatments and a summer cover crop just to see if we can shade with anything that'll come up at the moment that are actually working fairly well. The summer cover crop looks great. It's the only thing that people go by, they'll go, oh, hey, stuff's coming up. But yeah, it's cover crop, that's okay, something's coming up. So, one of our biggest issues is, other than the weather and getting it to cooperate, would be the general aggressiveness of the species that we're dealing with. I checked this morning because I got down here 2 hours early, and it's hip deep. It is hip deep clayberg, and you have to dust yourself off and shake yourself off before you go to your next little plot so you don't recontaminate your plot. And it has completely, anything that wasn't sprayed has been taken over. You can't tell the difference between my controls and anything that had seed put in it. So, also, we have, it's coming back from the established crowns and rhizomes and stone lines, but we also have seed bank recruitment was an issue. And now we're dealing with the ones that we have knocked the clayberg back. We have other invasive species like the lovely McCartney rose that, since they're not mowing anymore, has come back with a vengeance. And also in the lower spots, the deep red sedge has jumped up. The last little thing, and this is more further down the road for somebody if I can get all this going and all the hard stuff's done, they get to come in and figure out what to do as far as long-term maintenance, because restoration is pointless if you don't have a management plan in place. If we don't take care of it, if we don't have some way to manage it and maintain it, it's going to go right back to what it was or turn into a thicket. But it won't do that because it's underneath the high voltage line. It'll go right back to the invasive grasses. Ultimately, we're hoping to add an educational element into it where the public can come in, hope, maybe, I pray for prescribed burning. I don't hold my breath on it, but I pray. And an element of animals for grazing. We're trying to work with high schools, 4-H, FFA, these kids around here that have projects that could come out possibly and graze, and then they get the benefit of using the prairie, and the prairie gets the benefit of the animals being on there between grazing and the natural fertilization, and the public gets to learn, hey, if you graze a prairie, it does not destroy it unless you just do it wrong. It has to be disturbed and maintained, and this is a big part of it. So, and that's it.
All right, questions? The Memorial Park Prairie is kind of in four segments on either side of Memorial Drive and on either side of the railroad.
Mm-hmm.
Is this being considered for all four segments or just the segment where you are now, which has the worst problem of the grasses?
Very good question. Actually, we're hoping to develop a protocol that can be used throughout the park, and not only throughout the park, but KR and Clayburg are a whole lot other places than just a Memorial Park. Big problem issue grasses for a lot of people, whether it's wildlife, ranchers, extension agencies. So we want to do a protocol for the park, but also have something relevant for anybody that has an issue with this grass or grasses.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Have y'all looked at anything that can control the KR blue stem? Naturally, like in the soil, like I'm working with Betsy Ross on a project where she's helping us change the soil. We're pulling away from using herbicides altogether, and we're converting the soil to try and encourage the natives and discourage invasives. And I can't tell you any more about it. It's technically even that because she's working on the soil chemistry component of the biology. But have y'all considered any of those routes of looking at trying to manage it or use the soil in a way that helps progress the transformation?
We've talked about it, but with our budget and everything else, our goal is more to see if we can shade it out with something else and go that way. Because we're trying to make it applicable, like I said, for a rancher that's got 15,000 acres, he's not going to want to go through and redo all the soil in it to try to get the invasives knocked back.
Right. What is your summer cover crop?
My summer cover crop is a mix of iron cowpeas, sorghum, foxtail millet, I actually think we got a couple of other peas in there, but I can't remember what they are right off the top of my head. But basically just something that's stout that will come up in the heat of the summer. A lot of C4, and then peas come up anytime. So
assuming switchgrass shaded out the blue stem, what would be your plan for getting rid of the switchgrass?
Well, for one, we didn't go with the Alamo, which is the big wolfy one that everybody doesn't like and kind of ugly. I like it, but I'm a grass person. So. it's actually Blackwell. So if we can even get it established, which right now is looking kind of bleak, it's easier to get rid of that switchgrass than it is the KR and everything else. So if we have to go in and grub it out, we got to get it established first before we worry about getting rid of it. Yes.
Well, as far as the herbicides go, I'm so concerned about all the native species. It's a very special prairie, and it's got over 275 natives, and it just seems like I'm just worried about them getting herbicided.
For one, we used glyphosate, which is like Roundup. It's contact. It doesn't drift, and we made sure we didn't do anything like get out there and spray when the wind was high. And the only places we had kills was the plots that we sprayed. All around it, I checked, like I said, I checked it this morning. We've got native forbs coming back. We got vetch, the prairie parsley, all that kind of stuff that was there that wasn't killed when we did the treatment. So, and that's the other thing, we had the fence up when we did the spraying, so there was no somebody's dog getting in there and running across wet spray and then running across somewhere he doesn't need to be in and have accidental kill that way. It's a risk, but it's one of those things, it's kind of like fire. If you use fire, there's a chance of it getting away from you. If you do the best you can to be as responsible as possible, it's just another tool in your belt. And that's just kind of how I have to live with it.
All right, bell's 5 minutes.